for this invitation. So it's a real pleasure to give a talk. And here I will give a talk of a qualitative analysis on the PDE model of neural networks. So it's a PDE that I work since several years with my collaborators, which are here, Maria Caceres, José Antonio Cario, Kota Ikeda, Bona Pertam, Pierre Roux, Ricarda Schneider, and Didier Smets. So what is the general problematic? The general problematic that we're interested is how collective neural dynamics can emerge from individual neurons. So so the answer may depend on several aspects. So for example, what is the intrinsic dynamic of each neuron that we choose? Which kind of coupling between the neurons? And does the complex pattern can emerge from memory effects for delay of transmission or some other aspects? Okay, so here I'll try to give some answer of this question by considering a typical equation that I will give you in a few seconds or minutes. So just before, let us tell you which intrinsic dynamic of the neuron we will choose. So we will choose to describe the dynamic with respect to its membrane potential. So here I took a drone from internet, where I think that everybody knows this kind of phenomena. So here we have the membrane voltage. So if there are no stimulus, in general, the voltage is essentially constant. So sometimes the neuron can spike spontaneously. Hein? And if we here, at least in the drone, if we make a stimulus, so either the stimulus is too small, and so it comes back to its resting potential, either the stimulus is big enough, and here we have the membrane voltage goes to here that we call the value which induce the spike of the neurons. And after this spike, we see that the membrane voltage decrease very rapidly. And here we see that before coming back to its resting potential, there is that we call in general a time interval where the neuron cannot discharge. Okay, so this phenomenon involves several complex processes. So here, as we consider neurons that interact the one with each other, we will choose a very simple dynamic for the unique neuron, which is a dynamic of integrate and fire type. Okay, so now let's see the models that we have chosen. So, and I didn't say in the beginning, but it is essentially a mathematical result, and there is no application with experimental data. Hein? So, it's a mathematical result. So here, what is the model? So it is a model proposed by Brunel and Hakim, and in their model, they have compared it with experimental data. So except that they consider finite number of neurons, and here we consider formally the limit when the neurons goes number of neurons goes to plus infinity. So the neuron is described, as I said before, by its membrane potential. So V can go to minus infinity to Vf, and Vf is the membrane potential where the neuron spike. And we assume that when the neurons spike, instantaneously, the neurons come back to the reset value, which we call Vr. Okay, so of course, Vr is a constant which is strictly less than Vf. Okay. So now, if we look at the equation, so we have. So P of Vt denotes the density of neurons at time t with a membrane potential V at minus infinity Vf. We assume that P of Vft equals zero because when the neuron sparks instantaneously, it comes back to Vr. Okay. And in the equation, we have several terms. So we have a term of drift, which models the leaky integrate and fire dynamic. And we have a diffusion, which models the noise. And on the right hand side, we have here a Dirac mass at phi equal Vr. So this means that this models the fact that the neuron with discharge come back to the value Vr. And how we compute n of t? N of t is equal to minus, so here in front of the diffusion, we can put a parameter A. So n of t is equal to minus A dp or dv at Vf. Okay, so this means that this equation is relatively difficult because here the flux of neuron is construct with respect to the derivative of p at the boundary. Okay, so to control n of t, we have to control relatively height derivative of p. Okay, so here it's the equation, but I didn't explain what is the green part. So the green part models the interaction between the neurons. Okay, and how we do this? We put here a parameter B, which models the strength of interconnection. So if B is strictly positive, an X of T, sorry, is amplitude of stimulation that receives the neuron, the network at time T. So this means that X of T is positive. Okay, so here we see that as B equals zero, so if B equals zero, it's very good because the system is linear. Okay, there is no interaction. If B is strictly positive, we have interaction and we see that Bx, as Bx of t is positive, the drift have a tendency to put the neuron to the value Vf. Okay, so we see that in this situation, the network is excitatory. Conversely, if B is negative, B of x of t is negative, so the drift term have a tendency to put the neurons in the direction of minus infinity. Hence, in this situation, we say that the network is inhibitory. Okay. Okay. So now that we have this, we have to determine how we can compute the global amplitude of stimulation that receives the network at time t. So there is many ways to choose x of t. It depends of what kind of what do you choose of model and what kind of modelization you want to choose. So here I will consider two choices. So the first choice is simply to say that the global amplitude of stimulation is exactly equal to the flux of neurons with discharge. Okay, so so this means in particular that we have an instantaneous transmission. Why? Because the n of t instantaneously, so here x of t is equal to n of t, n of t instantaneously reacts on the drift term. Okay, and so it's the more natural way to one of the more natural way to define x of t, but as we will see, it's not very comfortable. I will explain why, and we have made work to explain this with Cario Pertam and Didier Smets, and I will we will see after, and there are many other people that work on this equation even recently. And after we have considered x of t equal n of t minus d. So we say, okay, when x of t equal n of t, there's many problems. And in particular, we cannot see periodic solutions. So some complex patterns which allow to explain phenomena of synchronization of neurons. And we can say, okay, maybe this is because we have forgot, we have do not take into account the fact that there is a delay of transmission. Okay, so after we have consider x of t equal n of t minus d, and we have tried to see what happened in this context. Okay, and ah, sorry, j'ai pas, I didn't see.
So the question just arrived. So yeah, if
yes,
you...
okay, nice, because I didn't. Okay,
it just arrived right now.
Okay, now I do not have idea how to measure B. No, but Brunel and Hakim have made some use of, well, not exactly this model, but some this kind of model with a finite number of neurons, and they have make comparison with experiments. But me personally, I didn't look experimental data. I just look
Yeah.
The theoretical part. So I don't know exactly how they measure B. Maybe they try different value of B, and but N is computed directly with the equation.
So there was a question to clarify if people didn't look at the chat. There was a question of from Aziz. So you didn't show any experimental data, but do we have any idea? So I guess Dasvin is referring to the paper of Brunel and Hakim to measure B.
Yes, but me, I do not know exactly how they did, because I essentially interested about the mathematical aspect of this equation. And we will see, in fact, that when we look, we'll see it after. In fact, when we look this equation, at least when x of t equal n of t, we see that this equation in general is not well defined. So in fact, it is a limit. If in fact the dynamic may be very different if you took the limit and if you took a finite number of neurons. So until I think that until the problem is well defined, okay, it's okay. But we see that here when there are some problems which appear, I will explain after. And in this situation, okay, it's not a good idea. Well, it's not a good idea. We say that this means that there is a, what we call a blow up, and this means that there are too many neurons which discharge at the same time, and this limit just tell you that okay, it's too complicated to consider too much neurons. In fact,
maybe if I can, so once you came back, it is worth to just take a little time so people can understand. If not, we are going to be lost. While the variables are quite meaningful. So so the P. So I just write again just to clarify.
Oui.
So okay, so the P denotes the density of neurons at time t at a given potential. All
oui,
right, and
right with a membrane potential V. Yes.
Yeah, and then so when it spikes, it doesn't take in account. So it's
when
what's, yeah.
Yes, when it spikes, it's instantaneously come back. So here I don't have blackboard. When I was in reality in front of the people, I take the blackboards to explain. So here I do not have a blackboard. So maybe here, okay, we see here with numerical simulation. Okay.
All right.
So V equal 1, here is the VR. So you see here with the pike, with the that, okay. And here at VF, it's the neuron which discharge. And okay, so we always have P at VF equals 0, and the neuron which discharge come back here at V equal 1. So this is one why we see here the pike, the discontinuity, in fact.
But so the P is the density, why?
Yes,
P is the density. It should be between 0 and 1? No.
Sorry, no, it's between minus infinity and Vf. Here in the simulation, Vf equal 2.
Right.
And Vr equal 1.
But your p takes value, okay.
Ah, no, my p takes the value what you want. It should be positive, non-negative.
All right. All right.
And what you must have is that the integral of p dv is equal to 1.
All right, that's it. Okay.
Because the probability of finding a neuron at time t is rose
Yeah,
equal to
it's the
one.
density.
But
Yeah.
you
All
have
right.
to integrate in V before.
All
And
right.
you can check that with the boundary condition, with the definition of n of t, which is equal here to minus dp of db, the term with the diffusion when you integrate exactly compensates the term on the right-hand side.
All
Okay.
right. Thank you.
Okay, so there is two choices. On the so let us begin with the first choice. So as I will say, it's not. In fact, the problem is if you want to find some interesting patterns in this case, either it is a more natural thing to study at the first step. We see that it is relatively complex. So why? So here, what is the problem? The problem is that the networks. The total activity of the networks acts instantaneously on the networks. And more precisely, for all b bigger than zero, so if you choose b bigger than zero, whatever the value of b, even if b is very small, if you choose an initial data well, so more precisely, what does we mean by well-chosen initial data? If you choose an initial data which is enough concentrated near VF, you have blow up. This means that you cannot define globally the solution of this equation. So it's a result of Caceres, Cario, and Pertin. And after, there are several results on this also, very precise results of Delarue, Inglis, Rubenthaler, and Torrey. Conversely, if B is negative, so here it is good, we have a globally well-defined solution. So now if you want to understand, what happened more precisely in the excitatory case? What happened if we make simulations? We obtain essentially two types of dynamics. Either we have convergence to a stationary state, either we have blow-up. So this means that the spectrum of the dynamic is not very rich in some sense, because either you have automatic convergence to stationary state, either you have blow up and the solution is not defined globally. Okay, so if you make simulations, so here is the first simulation. So I take this from Cario, Caceres, and Pertin. So at t equals zero, you have an initial data like that, and you see that here the solution converge to a stationary state. Okay. And I just recall you that the flux of neuron is minus the derivative of p at VF. So the bigger is the derivative at VF, the bigger is the drift here. Okay. So here it is the case when the initial data is not close and is not concentrated close enough around VF. So now we take another initial data. Yeah, which is more concentrated around VF. Huh? So here it's like this. Here it's a little bit more concentrated around VF. So what happened? So you see, we see that the derivative gets bigger and bigger, and at finite time, the derivative is essentially equal to plus infinity. So what does this mean? Does this mean that here you will have something like b multiplied by plus infinity? So it's not exactly this, but essentially it's this. So this means that at finite time, you cannot define the solution. Okay? So this is that it is observed that we have these two kinds of dynamics, and unfortunately, we never observe periodic solution. And in neuroscience, we like to observe periodic solution because we say, okay, it's very nice. We have phenomena of synchronization or something like this. Okay. So if you want to understand more precisely what happens, let us see what happened for the simplest solution, that is the stationary state. Okay. So if you look the stationary state, so it's also a result of Caceres, Cario, and Bertram. What we observe that if b is small enough, we have a unique stationary state. For intermediate range, we have at least two stationary states. This does not mean that we find periodic solution, unfortunately. At least numerically, we don't observe it. And if B is large enough, there is no stationary state. Okay, so in particular, if B is large enough, as there is no stationary state, the good part is that we cannot converge to stationary state. The idea is to search a dynamic which is more interesting than the convergence to stationary state. But the bad news is that if there is no stationary state, in fact, essentially there is blow up. Okay, so it's not very good. So, okay, so now if you want, okay, donc, we see that the dynamic is seems to be not very, not very, I would not say interesting, but not very, how we say in English? There is no, okay.
Exciting.
Pardon?
Exciting.
Oh, je ne sais pas si c'est exciting, but il y a pas beaucoup de possibilités différentes, quoi. There's not many possibilities, but we have nevertheless we have interested and it's not easy to prove even the its convergence to stationary state. We have tried to understand what can we say theoretically on this equation. Okay, so the first work of this is a work of Cáceres Carrión and Pertam, which considers the case where there is no interconnection. So here it's very good because the system is linear, and they can prove by, so I don't give the details of the proof, but it's a classical entropy inequality. They find an estimate like this, and after, by using Poincaré estimate, they prove that essentially the solution converges to a stationary state with an exponential rate. Okay?
Which, quickly, the norm in which which is the what's the setting?
Quickly, in L2.
L2, all right.
Yes, in
okay.
L2. Yeah.
Okay, thank
you. Because it's P infinity of V, P over P infinity minus 1 square. So it's P minus P infinity square over P infinity. So we have a weight with respect to the P infinity here is the stationary state.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's L2 estimate with a weight depending on the stationary state. So it's here.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, right.
Exponential decreasing of P minus P infinity square over P infinity.
All right. Thank you.
So now the question is what happens if B is different from zero? And so it's the results that we have met now since a few times, because 6 years now. And what we have obtained. We have obtained that in the inhibitory case, we have uniform estimates on the flux of neurons with respect to B and the initial data. So I don't give the details of the proof, but what is interesting here is that the estimate that we obtain, so assuming T large enough, is that this estimate does not depend on B and on the initial data. So this means that we can have a very strong nonlinearity, because even if B is negative, if B is very large in absolute value, the nonlinearity is very high. So it's difficult, very difficult to deal with. Okay, fine, it's difficult. And we have proved uniform estimate. And in the inhibitory case, if B is small enough, we have a global attractor. So this means that taking an initial data, so we have to define P minus P infinity over P infinity, okay, in L2. But assuming that, we have convergence to stationary state with exponential rate, okay? So here it's for the inhibitory case, that is the case where we do not see the phenomena of blow up. Now, if we see the phenomena of blow up, we have some kind of same result, except that as we know that whatever B, we always can choose an initial data such that we have blow up, of the results must depend on the initial data and on B. So here we have obtained some kind of this kind of results, but depending on the initial data on B. So this means that we can control N in L2 depending on the initial delta and B, and we have exponential convergence to unique stationary states, but for sufficiently weak interconnection and with respect to the initial data. So this means that in the excitatory case, we do not have a global attractor, and it is not true that we have a global attractor. And the existence of periodic solution, not numerically observed. Okay, so I think that I don't have many. Okay, so I didn't put the proof of this, huh? But Iris will pass of what happened. What happened now if we had a delay? Okay, we say that we have seen some problem before is that we have instantaneous transmission, which leads to the fact that at least in the excitatory case, the problem is not well defined in general. So we say, okay, we will add, maybe that's because we didn't add the delay. So if we add the delay, what happened? So here we are happy because as we are no delay, there is no more blow up. And we have existence and uniqueness of a global classical solution. So it's very good. And we also have, we can prove by the same kind of argument that we have used here. That we have exponential convergence to a unique stationary state as soon be small enough with the same kind of assumption that we have some the case without delay. Okay, so what is important here is that the convergence to the stationary state is only made when b is small enough, that is when we are almost linear, because either we do not control enough the thing to say to say something very strong on the qualitative solution. Okay, then now the question. So okay, and now we have had a D. Is there a periodic solution? And what we can say is that okay. What we know is that the stationary state. Alors, je regarde juste si j'ai pas une question supplémentaire. Yes, the delay regulates all because we lose the instantaneously transmission. In fact, what we have proved, I didn't say how we prove this, we have controlled some upper solution to control all this, and it is good. There is no problem. The real problem is really when the transmission is instantaneous.
The technique, so for the existence and uniqueness, what's the technique? Fixed alors, point or?
The technique, there is two techniques. The first technique is to make a change of variable like a Stefan problem, which was made by for this kind of equation, also by Cario, also by Delarue, Anglis, and Rimenthaler. And with this, what we obtain that by a fixed point, okay, we can define the solution on a very small time interval. But the problem is that we don't know that the time interval is larger than the delay d. Okay. So, because if you want to reapply it again and again, okay, this time interval should be larger than D. And so the first part is to say, okay, we have a local solution. So given here data, we have a local solution which depend on the infinitum of this solution. And in second step, in parallel, we construct a upper solution of this equation. And this upper solution allows us to give a control of n of t and to say, we can construct the solution on a time interval deep, and after we can construct again and again, and it's finished. But so it's passed by the first change of variable, which changes this equation to a diffusion equation with a term, right hand side term. Okay, so we can write by the solution semi-explicitly. This allows us to have an implicit equation of n of t modulo the change of variable. As we have an implicit equation of n of t, we can make a fixed point, but for a small enough time interval. And after the question is, can we do this? Does this allow us to have a global solution? And the answer is yes, because we can construct an upper solution which gives the control of n of t and which allow us to continue this local distance.
Thank you. Thanks for the detail. It's clear. Thank you.
Sorry. Oh, but which, so I took it. It's written in this slide. Voilà. okay, so the super solution allows to obtain uniform estimates and to have global existence. So now if you, now can we have a periodic solution? So if you look at the stationary state, we see that the stationary state are the same than if d equals zero, okay? And what we have seen that if b is large enough, we do not have stationary state. So this means that here, that if b is large enough, the solution cannot converge to stationary state. Moreover, the solution is well defined globally. So maybe if you are a little, how is it in English, naive, we think a little too fast, we say, okay, it's very good, we do not have stationary state, so we cannot converge to stationary state. The solution is globally defined, we will find a periodic solution. In fact, the answer is no. It is a relatively intuitive when we say numerical simulation. We have, in fact, no periodic solution observed without delay in the excitatory case, and no periodic solution if we add a delay. And if b is large enough, in fact, what happened of n of t, so it cannot effectively converge to stationary state, but we observe oscillation which gets bigger and bigger, and we have n of t which goes to plus infinity with this kind of oscillation. So what we can observe is that there is a large peak and the distance between the two large peaks seems to be the same. But after... Okay, so even with a delay, we do not have periodic solution, at least in the excitatory case. Either there is too much model. So if you add a refractory state, adding to the delay, you can obtain periodic solution in the excitatory case.
Excuse me, Delphine. So what's the y-axis? Because it's erased.
N of t.
N of t. All right. Thank you.
So here it's the flux of neurons with discharge. Yeah. And here is the time t. Okay. So now, so in the excitatory case, you do not have a periodic solution. Now what happened in the inhibitory case? So we say, okay, in the inhibitory case, so it's certainly better, we don't have periodic solution. But in fact, Brunel have seen some past year, have made some numerical simulation of this equation, and they have found some periodic solution. And here, so it's a work with Pierre Roux, Kota Ikeda, and Didier Smith. We have to try to understand what can we say about the periodic solution for the inhibitory case. So without delay, of course, there is no periodic solution for the inhibitory case, at least numerically observed. Hein? And with delay, we observe interesting pattern. So more precisely, so I make, je vais changer, alors attends, je vais faire un nouveau partage. Non, alors je vais pas faire comme ça. Je vais faire ça et je vais faire un nouveau partage. Pop. Partage l'écran. Ok. Ok, so I make, so it's numerical solution. For in the inhibitory case, when b negative, so inhibitory case, and d not too small. So what we observe? We'll observe this. Some a wave which goes from the left to the right. Okay. And so what we wanted to do, we wanted to understand more precisely, can we make some theoretical results on this observation? And in fact, the problem is very, very complex. Enfin, at least we'll see that the problem is very complex. Up. Voilà. So the equation is this one. So it's the same equation that I gave you before, except here that I put a parameter A. So what we have seen, we have said, okay, if the intercalation are strong enough, we have complex pattern, but the solution is too much complex to étudier, to study. Okay, let us just, I mention a result of Cormier, Torre, and Vels. We have proved some periodic solution, not exactly on this equation, but of this kind of equation with random discharge. Okay, but it's not the setting of here. So here, just in this setting, at least we do not know the problem of periodic solution, is that it is very difficult to tackle theoretically. So what idea we had, so we will see that there is some conjecture in our results. We assume that the daily transmission is very small, and we have tried to say, okay, maybe there is a methodology which where we can say something when b goes to minus infinity. Okay, and what we want to say is that the solution p is like a Gaussian, like this, with a speed which goes like c of t, so a Gaussian wave it goes from the left to the right, plus a remainder time, which is very small, which have to be very small. And what we have proved, so it's not very difficult, it's not difficult to prove this, huh? Okay? We have proved that the remainder term is satisfies this equation. So this means that if you prove that the flux of neuron goes to zero when b goes to minus infinity, you know that the remainder term is relatively small. Okay. So we don't know how to prove that n of t goes to zero when b goes to minus infinity, but numerically it's clearly true. Okay. So here's the first thing that okay. It is reasonable to say that there is a question. Poop. I don't understand the question. And a stay with daily increase periodically. Je comprends pas la question. I don't understand the question.
No, maybe we can it is written, we can come back at the end of the talk, because it's okay.
Okay. So it's the first problem is okay, even prove then when b is large, n of t goes to zero is very difficult because we are in height nonlinearity. The second problem is, okay, if you want to prove that there is periodic solution, so a wave like we observe in the movie that I show you, we have to understand what is C of t. And if we see what is C of t here, it's solution of this equation. But here, C is not a closed equation. C depends on n, which itself, n of t minus d here, it's not minus one, which itself depends on the equation. Okay, so we say, but whatever, we have made another approximation and say that n of t is like dvp of vf, and we assume that dvr multiplied by b is very small. If we do this, we have a closed equation of c, which is like this. So here is that here where is a strong conjecture, okay? And so the conjecture is strong. We don't know if it is true, but assuming it is true, Okay, we are reduced to study this equation. So we say that essentially, P of TV, the behavior of P of TV is like phi of V minus C of T, where C of T is solution of this equation. So the question now to prove periodic solution is to consider this Delay equation. So we reduce the problem to a Delay equation. And so we have proved the first theorem with Kota Ikeda, Pierre-Roux, and Didier Smets. So assume that B is small enough and D large enough. We have some assumption on VF. Then we have non-trivial periodic solution of this equation. So the idea of proof is inspired from Adler and Tomiuk. So I don't give the detail here. But the second part that we have interested in is, okay, now we know that we can have periodic solution, but can you describe more precisely the periodic solution? So give some kind of profile of this solution. And so it's the last step. So to do this, we have chosen D equal 1 and VF equal 0. So we can observe that D equal 1 and VF equal 0 do not satisfy this assumption. But okay, when we have searched the profile, we didn't check this. We just tried to remove all the constants, to do not have too much constant in our computations. So okay, so here we consider D equal 1 and VF equal 0. So the solution is this one. And okay, so is there a periodic solution? And can we make a better description of this solution? So what we have made, so the problem, okay, is that when B is very large, C of T take very, very high value. So we have to make a change of variables that I make here. So it's a little bit technical, maybe. So maybe I can pass it because it's too much technical. You will understand nothing. So by this change of variable, so U, it's beta ln. So you don't look at C, but ln of C over beta, multiplied by beta. And if you look this, you see that the solution converges to a profile. So here it's this draw is to explain the proof, but we don't explain the proof. The profile is very simple. It's P of T is equal to is a function which is decreased like with speed one from CM to zero, and after there is a jump and it decreases again from C1 to zero. Okay, so this means if we traduct it by again a change of variable, this means that essentially we expect that the time interval, the length of the time interval of the periodicity grow like ln of b, and that the solution goes very fast from the left, or very fast, it's like b power some constant, b power cm, something like this, and come back exponentially to the right. So it's very the speed is very, very large, from the maximum speed is very, very large, and the length of the periodic solution is like ln of b. Okay, so we have made some numerical simulation to compare our approximation with the solution. So we see it's okay, it's not exactly the same thing, but it looks like a little bit. But the problem it is that it is very difficult to check numerically if our approximation is good, because it is an approximation when B is very, very, very large. And okay, it's around ln of B. And so we can say approximatively ln of B is bounded. That's not true, huh? But ln of B grows very, very slowly. And we cannot make numerical simulation which are good, which well converge if B is too large. So it's difficult, in fact, to compare, but we think that the results are quite okay, it's a first good first step to consider this very difficult problem, even if there is many a conjecture and there are many open questions. Okay, so I think that I finished, and I thank you very much.